Ladies and gentlemen, let me first say my name is Arne Ardeberg. I'm representing the academy and the university here. More important, you are all most welcome to a most exciting day. Let me first introduce the Crawford Prize. Pure science, as we all know, is widely acknowledged as important. The praise is abundant, but the funding is quite a bit less abundant. We need help. Holger Lundquist Crawford was born 1908 in rather modest circumstances, but that was largely compensated by a clever, determined, and loving mother and a very talented son. And in the family, education was highest priority. And Holger ended up a Stockholm School of Economics best student. He was very quickly recruited to Åkerlund & Rausing here in Lund. 35, he married Anna-Greta, and he was the managing director of Åkerlund & Rausing for 22 years, following which he was the chairperson of the board for another 4 years. He made Åkerlund & Rausing a world-leading company, and equally he made Tetra Pak a world-leading name. He founded in 1964 Gambro, the artificial kidney. He had numerous posts in Swedish industry and many posts in banks and insurance companies. He was all the time a highly interested benefactor of culture and of science. He was a Swedish grand personality, very well known. In 1980, he established the Crawford Foundation, and I read, promoting scientific training and research, care, upbringing and education of children and young people. The foundation capital is today 3 billion Swedish kronor. And we can see here how the capital has grown, quite remarkable growth. And it's even more remarkable if one compares to everything that has been awarded up to now, about 1 billion SEK. So those of you, I hope many, continuing with an academic career should remember this. Some results here in Lund: the Holger Crawford Center of Economics, the Center for Language and Literature, very big things, both of them, and the Locus Medicus Lundensis. The Crawford Foundation board was chaired until 2007-2008 by Dr. Margareta Nilsson, daughter of Holger Crawford, and from 8 on it is chaired by Dr. Ebba Fischer, granddaughter of Holger Crawford, and the managing director is Dr. Lennart Nilsson. The Crawford Prize, we celebrate here, was established in 1980 through a donation from Anna-Greta and Holger Crawford to the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences. And it was earmarked for fundamental research in mathematics, astronomy, geosciences, biosciences, and arthritis. Some people are clever academics. Some are successful industrialists. Some are talented innovators, and some are driving leaders. Holger Crawford was all of this in one person. And in our high favor, exceedingly generous. And his family follows the same path. May I ask the chair, Ebba Fischer, to stand up, and I think we should give her an applause. It is hard, if at all possible, to exaggerate the importance of the Crawford Foundation for the research at Lund University and elsewhere. Thank you very much. Now I give the word to Tobias.
Okay, thank you. So my name again is Tobias Ekholm, and I'm representing the Royal Academy and the Prize Committee for Mathematics, and it's my great honor to introduce to you the Crawford Prize winner in mathematics, Jakob Ilyashberg. And the here we go. And the prize motivation is for the development of contact and symplectic topology and groundbreaking discoveries of rigidity and flexibility phenomena. So I'm going to give a very short description of some of Ilyashberg's work. And in order to do so, I would like to start with saying one word at least about geometry. So up in the top left corner, you see a wire with some kind of soap film surface on it. And this is a typical problem in geometry. You take a wire and you dip it in soapy water and you ask what surface does the soapy water form on the wire. And it's a very interesting problem, but here we are not going to look at it from this interesting point of view, but just observe that if I take the wire with its surface and I sort of start moving to the left, then the whole soap surface follows suit, right? There's no point in the surface staying and then the wire just moving. It's moving with its boundary, and this is a typical rigidity phenomenon. So the surface in some sense is rigid. Now one can relax the geometric surface and say that let's pretend that it's completely elastic. We can, you know, not tear it apart, but we can make a long bulge. So instead of following suit, a part of it can stay and other parts can move. So it's becoming like a very rubber spaced geometry. And that kind of geometry is called topology. And topology, it turns out, is somehow even more flexible than what you would expect. So up in the right corner of the pictures, you see a plane curve. So it's a curve that you have seen. It's somehow the trace of a particle moving, and the particle is allowed to move only with non-zero speed everywhere. And then we can ask, so we try to deform this curve within the class of such curve, non-zero speed. It turns out the only thing you have to do is you have to count the number of turns that the tangent does as you move along. So this curve, for example, the tangent does 3 turns, it can be deformed to a curve which just goes 3 times around the standard circle. So maybe this doesn't sound very impressive, but when you come to the next dimension, you see the picture below. Then you have a two-dimensional sphere in a three-dimensional space, just your usual sphere, and we paint the outside of this sphere with gold and the inside with purple. And now, if you would count the counterpart of counting turns, it turns out that there is only one thing to count, it's only 0. So there is no, the place where, which corresponds to this tangent vector is just you can deform completely everything to everything else. And the thing that governs such extreme flexibility called H principle. So here we see a sort of surprising movie, or at least a picture of stills, which turns the sphere inside out without ever tearing or making a hole in the sphere. You can push it through itself, but not somehow pull it tight. Okay. So the area that Ilyashberg works in is called symplectic and or contact geometry, and it's the geometry that describes classical mechanics. So up on the right, you see a picture where on the right, in this upper right picture, you see a pendulum. So it's just a mass, attached at the rigid rod, say sitting on a wall or lying on the table. And so this mass can move along a circle. And here we have the circular coordinate is horizontal, and it's not quite a circle, but if you tie it up, it would become a circle. And that's the position coordinate, and then we have another axis which basically encodes the velocity or the momentum, if you wish. And the classical mechanics works as follows, that the small infinitesimal rectangles of position and momentum, they are preserved under the motion, and this then governs some sort of geometry. Down in the below that you see what's called the standard contact structure on three space. So contact geometry is what happens when you restrict this first type of the classical mechanics to an energy hypersurface. So you enter odd dimensions, and this little position momentum plane starts in some sense turning, and that's the contact structure. So here you see a plane at each point, and as you move out to infinity, it rotates almost a straight angle, but not quite. Now, this geometry, in some sense, given to us by maybe classical mechanics, but in mathematics you say that there are some differential forms that governs the geometry. And it's not clear from the start whether this geometry behaves like the minimal surface that I pull along or the sphere that I can turn inside out. And so you can ask, is the geometry flexible or is it rigid? And surprisingly, in this case, the answer is that it is both. And Ilyashberg has established several results in both directions, which are sort of truly fascinating. So first I would like to mention that these are titles of papers. A paper from back in 1989 is called Classification of Overtwisted Contact Structures on Three Manifolds. So it's of course a complicated story, but if you simplify it, you again see this sort of contact structure on the disk that I said turned almost a right angle. Now, turns out that if in your space, in your three-dimensional space, if you find such a disk where it turns exactly right angle, then the whole space becomes soft, and you can do whatever you want. So somehow then you can turn the sphere inside out, but slightly before this turn of pi half, it's in some sense rigid geometry. So it's a striking result which puts a very sharp borderline between rigid and flexible. The next result that I would like to mention is this symplectic field theory, which is illustrated in the lower corner. So that's a framework for detecting and studying rigidity phenomena. And schematically, what you're doing is you're counting certain surfaces in your space. And it turns out that these surfaces are not very much unlike the first surface of soap film that we looked at. And here in the picture, which is a little bit strange, you see two knots. And if you look at the knot on the left and you take this inner little circle and flip it over, you get the knot on the right. So they're somehow the same knot, they're just distorted a little bit. But it turns out that if you put the condition that these knots are tangent to this contact plane field that I drew, then you cannot deform one to the other. And that comes from counting certain such curves with boundary on the knot. And this symplectic field theory framework gives you literally thousands of equally interesting results and demonstrations of rigidity. And finally, I would like to mention a very recent result which basically takes this three-dimensional story and pushes it to arbitrary dimension and also settled long-standing question about which spaces admit contact structures. So to round off this presentation, I would also like to say that the field of contact and symplectic geometry through the work of Ilyashberg has become a very central piece of mathematics. So it's related to many other active areas. So something called low-dimensional topology, which is illustrated by this knot, and the complex geometry, which maybe I won't say very much about. And finally, also to high-energy physics and in particular to the more mathematical and topological versions of gauge theory, which is the theory that, for example, give you this the standard model of quarks and leptons. And string theory is supposed to unify this with gravity. And all the interesting phenomena in string theory, like, for example, mirror symmetry, which is a big area on the interface between mathematics and physics. So I will stop the presentation there. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Professor Ekholm, for this introduction. I am extremely honored to give this lecture and, of course, receiving this fantastic prize from Royal Swedish Academy and Kraft Foundation. So I'm also very happy to give this talk in Lund, where one of great mathematician, Professor Lars Hermander, worked, and his work was very much related to symplectic geometry, and he used the symplectic geometry in a very serious way in his research. So also very great to see so many young faces here, and I hope many of them will join our ranks of mathematicians. So essentially, Professor Ekholm already explained everything what I need to say, so just I have a few words to add. So so goal of mathematics is to reveal structure underlying phenomenon in real world, but also in the world which mathematicians themselves create. So when a new interesting structure is discovered, it usually defines the whole new world which mathematicians want to understand and explore. So sometimes this world as real as a real world, and if this kind of revealed structure turns out to be interesting and really good structure, and then this world kind of start to develop with finding new connection with some other mathematical and real world, and the subject start to live its own life. And if the structure is not so interesting, then this world eventually dies. So, and there was always exist two direction of exploration of this world. So one concerned with finding constraint and restriction. And I refer to this part as a rigidity side. So like first we just trying to understand the structure, and first thing we're trying to understand what we cannot do and what are kind of really rigid phenomena in this world. So this is a kind of cartoon for this part of the world. And there's the other one where the mathematician try to kind of test the limit of this world to find some kind of new construction, and often, if they like it, they discover some property which counterintuitive and unexpected, and this is what I refer to the second part. And so I begin with some extreme cases of this flexibility phenomenon, which I refer in mathematics. So let's start with this following problem. So many things in our world is described by differential equation and by system of differential equations. This the geometric object describes this way, physical world describes this way, and this is a like particular, for instance, example. If the equation is written, this is equation which determine what is called isometric embedding of plane into three space. So we take a two-dimensional plane and we move to three-dimensional space in such a way that distances between any two points remain the same. So this is, you can, for instance, if you take a sheet of paper, you can kind of bend it and you still don't disturb any geometry. So this is called isometric embedding, and this is a pretty rigid problem. So it clearly that you can take the sheet of paper, you can do something like this, but if you try to do something kind of more drastic, kind of, then you destroy some smooth structure, and you cannot do it without distorting the geometry. But in general, let's kind of think about this regardless of this particular problem. So given system differential equations, you can do the following strange thing. Just decouple function and its derivative. So we have this vector valued function x, and there is a two derivative. But you replace them by independent vector valued function x1 and x2, just having nothing to do with other. And then you get a system of just algebraic equations. And this is kind of some very simple problem. So what we're trying to have like two vectors depending on two parameters which have a length one and mutually orthogonal. And so this is, of course, very easy to do it. This is this system, algebraic system in this case, has a lot of solutions. So we will call a solution of this corresponding algebraic system, and sometimes it's not a system of equations, sometimes system of inequality, some any condition involving derivative. So I just refer it to differential relation instead. And existence of formal solution is a necessary condition for solubility of this one. But at the first glance, it looked like it's a completely stupid thing to do. We're just throwing out all this kind of really important thing. And clearly it should not be sufficient. But turns out that there are a lot of classes of problems when this solvability is sufficient, and this is represents some kind of extreme example of this phenomenon. So here's this. I'll give you two classical examples of this. So one was found by this famous mathematician who recently died, John Nash, and you of course seen all this movie Beautiful Mind about him. And the second by Steve Smale. And it concerned with, and this further developed by Kuiper and the Smale in cooperation with his student Hirsch. And one concerned with theory of C1 isometric embedding, and another with this immersion theory. An example of this immersion theory, Tobias just presented you say, a few minutes ago. So let me just start with the Smale's work. So this is this what already Tobias was talking about. This is a movie by Minnesota Geometry Center. So we're trying to invert sphere outside in. So it's painted gold outside and this red brown inside, and we're trying to inverted by doing the following thing. You're allowed to go through, but you're not allowed to create any sharp corner like singularity. So as soon as you create it, it just explodes. And so it looks like it's completely impossible, right? You're trying to do whatever you want, and it doesn't quite work. But then it turns out that it's still possible, and this is exactly the same picture. It's a little bit dark here, I'm sorry, but okay. Okay, of course you cannot understand what was going on here, but nevertheless there is a very simple mathematical procedure which was kind of illustrated here. So now the guy moving to Nash results. So again, as I already told you, there exists problem of isometric embeddings of, say, for instance, surfaces in three space. So we can try to, you have some already intrinsic metric on the surface, and you can realize this metric by putting the surface in three space. And there are a lot of constraints to this. For instance, like you ask, you take a round sphere and a sphere of radius one, and you have measurements on the sphere, and you're asking, is it possible preserving these distances? Is it possible to shrink this sphere of radius one to sphere of radius one-tenth or something, or even smaller? Intuitively, it's obviously impossible, right? Because like all our life is based on the fact that if you take, for instance, ping pong ball, and it's kind of rigid, it's not possible to squish it. And indeed, you can prove, turns out that very much depends on so-called class of smoothness of this embedding. So you can, in order to talk to measure distances, it's sufficient that our map is what is called C1 smooth. That means that you can just find this map and it can differentiate it, define this tangent vector and velocity vector. But it's not needed to be like C class C2, twice differentiable. But if it's twice differentiable, then it allows us to compute what is called curvature, it's kind of acceleration of when we're moving along this path. And the curvature of the sphere of big radius is small, and curvature of sphere of small radius is big. And it's clearly, if you kind of try to increase it, curvature has to increase. And curvature depends on second derivative. And so if it's C2 smooth embedding, you cannot really, you can prove it, you cannot squeeze it. But turns out, and this was discovered by Nash, that it's possible to do when you're trying to do just C1 smooth isometric embedding. And this is a kind of picture what you get, and this is a project. There is a group of mathematicians and computer sciences, and they created this kind of fantastic computer graphics. So you take a two-dimensional torus and you try to embed two-dimensional torus with a flat metric to three-dimensional space. So I already told you, so unfortunately I, okay, well, so if you take a sheet of paper, then you can bend it and isometrically, and you can make, for instance, cylinder still with a flat, okay. This is already bended, but anyway, you can roll it and make cylinder with flat matrix. And you can try to roll it this way. So in three spaces, it's kind of difficult to do. But if, for instance, in four-dimensional space, I could make this happen and have this two-dimensional torus with flat matrix. But then question, is it possible to realize in this space? And turns out that C1, it's possible. And it's done by some kind of method of successive approximation. So this was second approximation, this is the third approximation. So it's kind of becoming very, very fractal, but still it's C1 smooth. And this is kind of how look at it, a small scale. And the same, this is a picture of contraction of sphere into the ball. So you have this is the Earth with this map, and then you can squeeze it inside this inside itself, and still all geometry preserves. Like in this kind of small Earth inside, you can travel from point A to point B, and will be exactly the same distance, though this Earth is quite small. Okay, and this, they made it actually 3D printing of this, okay, on this Earth. So this is a very great modern mathematician, Mikhail Gromov, and he just a little bit enters this subject a little bit later than this Nash and Smail, and he really made some big revolution on it. So what he did, he really, you know, that what Gromov's mind worked kind of the following way. So he usually kind of read somebody's discovery, and then he understands what this person did much better than this person himself. And so what he read very kind of cleverly this, the work of Smail and Nash, and he really extracted from this some very basic construction, and then he then make them work in much, much more bigger generality, and there's a discovered a lot of different problem where this H principle type thing, this is called H principle. H state for the mathematical word homotopy, and homotopy means continuous deformation. It just means you have a formal solution, and this formal solution can be deformed into real solution. And even kind of more, if you have a two, you're asking, for instance, when Professor Ekholm was talking about this circle in the plane winding, and then if you have a two such immersion of circle, and like formally the number of rotation is the same, then you can this formal deformation realized by genuine deformation. So this is called H principle, and Gromov found a lot of such things. And for instance, he discovers that this phenomena of Nash with C1 isometric phenomena is in fact very broadly applicable. So in general, standard idea that like people were considering linear differential equation and then quasi-linear and then the idea that the more non-linear, the more difficult to solve them. But what Gromov realized that if it's really extremely non-linear, then it's again very easy to solve it, and that's the case what happened with Nash case. Okay, and so many of this flexibility result of Gromov were in symplectic geometry, and now I will move to explaining you what symplectic geometry is. So we'll start with this example, in fact, not symplectic geometry, but contact geometry. So symplectic geometry starts from dimension 2, and it exists in even dimension spaces, and contact geometry is an odd dimensional cousin or brother, depending on your point of view, of symplectic geometry. So let's consider the following question. So suppose you have a function of one variable, and now this function has a derivative. And you want to take a function and a derivative and to draw simultaneously graph of both. So you need to, so one coordinate is a value of function, a second coordinate is a value of derivative. So then you get a curve in three-dimensional space. So this curve satisfies differential equation, of course. So z coordinates is a value of function, y coordinates is a derivative, and so dz or dx is equal y, and you can write it that dz is equal y dx. So this equation, dz is equal y dx, so let's understand how to understand it. This is what is called dz minus y dx as differential one form, and it's nothing kind of scary in this word differential one form. It just means the following thing. So like, when you want to write, if you write linear equation, this linear equation refer to some, for instance, space, and if you write linear equation equal to zero, it defines plane in the space. But suppose you want to define not just one plane, but you want to define what is called field of plane. At every point, you have a different plane. And then you have this coordinate dz, dx, they refer to coordinates, linear coordinates at given point with, if you take a point with coordinate x, y, z, and there you consider this infinitesimal kind of coordinate dz minus dx, and so you get this plane field. At the point with coordinates x, y, z, you take a plane with a slope y with respect to this dz and dx coordinate. So you get this plane field. So this plane field is very interesting. So what we got, that our curve satisfies this differential equation dz minus y dx is equal to zero, that means that at every point this curve has to be tangent to this plane field. And this plane field is very interesting. It's what is called completely non-integrable. It's called contact structure. But still, as we'll I'll tell in a second, it does not have a complete non-integrability, implies that there is no tangent surfaces. So you cannot define surface which at every point tangent to this plane field. But there are plenty of curves, and they're called Legendrian, and this is some kind of picture how this Legendrian curve look like. They look like some kind of spiral. So this plane field is, as I said, called contact structure. So it's completely non-integrable in two sense. So one, it's, first of all, as I said, there is no integral surfaces, and the second, you can travel from any point to any other point in the direction tangent to this plane field, along a Legendrian curve. So you see, if you have an integral plane field, so all your space is filleted by the surfaces, for instance, like you take a dz equal zero, so that means you have a field of parallel planes. And you never can, from one sheet, get to another sheet going along this sheet. But if you have this non-integrable case, then you can do that. So this particular contact structure, dz minus y dx equal to zero, is called standard. And in fact, turns out that there are some other, and we'll discuss it later. So if you take a general Legendrian curve, the curve tangent, so it need not to be graphical. Like each graphical piece is indeed look like graph of function and its derivative. But in general, it look like graph of function and derivative where this function is multivalued. In particular, when I project it to XZ plane, then I get this type of picture with this, what is called cusp singularity, and this is called front projection of Legendrian curve. So we, in fact, encounter contact geometry every day. So this is just, so you, if, for instance, this is if you look at the skating rink and you look at the traces on ice, and you see exactly curve which would remind this front projection, and that is not accidental. They are precisely mathematically described as a projection of certain Legendrian curve. So when we're looking at the picture, oh, this is unfortunately not so, such a great lighting, but anyway, this is supposed to be some glass, and this is a, you have a reflection of light in this glass, and this reflection called caustic. And this caustic is, in fact, it's some kind of singularity of certain front projection of Legendrian manifold. And when you're parking a car, we do parallel parking, then kind of that's what you do, and this is precisely, again, front of some Legendrian curve. And if you study thermodynamics, you have a Carnot cycle, it's again some manifestation of contact geometry. So let me kind of give you one simple question about Legendrian curve, which generalized from the question of just graphical curve to the question of non-graphical. So in standard calculus, which many of you, if you already studied calculus, study in the text, there is a called Rolle's theorem, which says that if you have a function which have a on one variable and have a value equal at the end interval of this value, then this function at some intermediate point have to have a derivative equal to zero. So it's a, of course, obvious statement, right? So if you like travel from one point along the line and you travel in one direction with some speed, and you want to come back. So to come back, you have to stop and turn and go in opposite direction. If you're always going with a speed in one direction, it's difficult to return. If this is line, it's not Earth, for instance. So, and from this my Legendrian interpretation, it just means that you have a Legendrian graph which contain in upper half space, because y is precisely correspond to value of the derivative. So question, does the same true for any Legendrian curve? And the answer immediately obviously no, because if you consider such front, you see that you can like always go with positive slope, with positive speed, derivative every positive, but you end up lower than you started. So that's not, so therefore it doesn't, not true. But turns out that it's still true if you properly formulate the question. So let's consider in our context space, consider two plane, x equals zero and x equals one. And now suppose we consider all possible Legendrian curve between these two planes and with the condition that such Legendrian curve should be possible to deform to graphical one via what is called Legendrian isotopy, meaning through the family of Legendrian curve, which at never moment self-intersect. You not allow it to be self-intersecting. And you're asking, is it true for such curve that in z coordinate for the end point is lower than z point, z coordinate of on left side, if this curve contain in upper half space y equal to zero? So, and turns out that this is true. And I proved in 81, and there was some different proof found by Chikanov and Sikorov in 87. And what actually I proved the following thing, that if you take a front of such curve, that this front have a very kind of remarkable structure. You can always find in this front some special point, such that if you split off some kind of unnecessary pieces of this front, then what is left, you get piecewise smooth and continuous graph of some function. And then this function still have a positive derivative, and hence value at this end is greater than this one. So this theorem is also tightly related to some conjecture of another great mathematician who unfortunately also died not so long ago, Bill Thurston, and it was proven in 83. So this is certain kind of is his favorite Legendre knot. And this is a Daniel Benneken. And this conjecture of Thurston was the following. So if you take a three space and you take any closed Legendrian curve, then you never can find disk, two-dimensional embed disk in three space, such that its boundary along Legendrian knot is tangent to our contact structure. So this was a conjecture of Thurston proven by Benneken. And in fact, it's also, you can deduce it from this, my generalization of Rolle theorem I told you a second ago. So Thurston conjecture is this kind of Benneken theorem, can be reinterpreted, has the following corollary. So on three space, there are at least two different contact structures. You can take the standard contact structure, and you can take, in fact, find contact structure which does contain such disk. Because, you see, this non-integrability condition, it just means that our contact plane keep rotating along every tangent curve. For instance, you take this like vertical line, take a field of ray coming out of this line, and consider plane field which is rotate along every ray. So if they rotate not too much, like no more than 90 degrees, that's exactly you get a picture of standard contact structure. But if at some moment they flip or rotate for at least 180 degrees, then exist at this moment you get this. This Legendrian curve which violate this Benneken theorem. And so I call such contact structure with this property overtwisted, so that you can say that Benneken theorem implies this overtwisted contact structure is not isomorphic up to some smooth equivalence, not diffeomorphic to the standard one. So there is at least one tight and one overtwisted. But in fact, I proved the complete classification of this, and it says that on R3 there are, well, I said exactly 2 plus infinity of different contact structure, which means that there is a one contact structure which is standard. Then there is exactly one which is overtwisted infinity, which means that outside every ball, it still have this overtwisted disk as far as possible at infinity. And another one which at infinity tight, but still overtwisted. And not another one, but for every integer n, there exists exactly one such thing. So you get less what I said. So this can be all generalized to high dimensions. So when you, instead of simultaneous graph of function and its derivative, consider function of many variable and simultaneous graph of function and all its first derivative, and then you come to this high dimensional contact structure and this high dimension Legendrian submanifold and this Legendrian surfaces. And again, they are not necessarily graphical, but then project the front projection may have some singularity like this. Okay, so now let's turn to symplectic geometry. This was a kind of some brief introduction to contact geometry. Now let's go to symplectic geometry. I forgot, what time is it? I need to finish at 20. 45, okay, thank you. So let's consider this case. Let's take a plane, and you have this two formula. AB, you have two vectors, and AB cosine theta, and AB sine theta. So this first formula, what is called standard dot product or scalar product of two vectors. And the second one, it's an area of parallelogram spanned by these two vectors. So this area of parallelogram, so difference between this first one is symmetric bilinear form, and the second is skew-symmetric, which means that if you, in this case, you replace vector by the sum, all of them bilinear, so that means that if you say scale vector, then they all scale the same way. If you replace vector by sum, you get sum of such thing. But in first case, if you exchange the order a and b, you get plus, and in the second case, you get minus. So this this is a kind of typical leads to Euclidean geometry, and geometry on this form leads to symplectic geometry. So this form omega has also complex geometric interpretation. So if you, I hope most of you know the present audience, there is a, you can think about the planar vectors, the complex numbers. And then instead of you can multiply by any vector by I, and then you rotate this vector by 90 degrees. And so this form omega is just scalar product, standard Euclidean product, but of first vector rotated by I. So you can also consider omega as a differential form. So I already said, what does it mean to consider differential form? That means that you are allowed to apply it not necessarily to vector at given point, but vector at any point on the space. And there is a kind of standard calculus notation that in this case, this is just area form is the form dp dq. So this enables us, when you consider this as a differential form, we can talk about transformation preserving this form, which are not necessarily linear. If it's just at one point that we only can apply to it linear transformation, and linear transformation preserving Euclidean form is just rotation or reflection, and linear transformation preserving the symplectic form is a transformation which preserve area, and this is a linear transformation with determinant one. But if you consider non-linear, then you have an enormous number of transformation preserving area. So for instance, you can take a disk and do some kind of domain out of this and map one to another in such a way that area at every point preserve. So area form preserved. So in particular, it means that area of any subdomain is preserved. And so it's just reflected by this condition that this Jacobian determinant of this map is equal to one, which is the same as the preservation of this form. So there is a kind of the following interesting phenomenon we observe here, that this Euclidean isometries, even when you consider they non-linear, they still very, very constrained, right? Because still, if you want to, even by non-linear, you can want to preserve geometry at every point, that the only thing in addition to linear case you can do is do translation. So it's still finite dimensional group of such transformation, but as soon as you go to this area preservation case, you get a huge, huge in-dimensional group, and hence, you see, that you get this phenomenon that when you're studying Euclidean geometry, it's very rigid. So it really, word geometry somehow refers to us for something very rigid. But this area preserving transformation is very, very flexible thing. And so therefore, this study of this area preservation map is a kind of very topological feeling, and hence you get this word symplectic topology. So you can do exactly the same thing in high dimensions. For instance, you can take a space R to n and think about this as complex n-dimensional space and consider the form omega, which is just Euclidean form twisted by this multiplication by I. And again, this is a, you can write it as a differential form. And the meaning of this form is, again, you just take two vectors and you project this to coordinate plane p1, q1, p2, q2, p1, qn, and take a sum, you get a parallelogram project into all this plane, and take a sum of area of all this parallelogram, and that is called symplectic form. And what is interesting about this symplectic geometry of this form, that there are plenty of subspaces on which this form is identically equal to zero. For instance, you can, they called isotropic. And in particular, there is a subspace on which this n-dimensional subspace, half-dimensional subspace, on which this form vanishes. And this is a subspace called Lagrangian. And it just means that rotation, multiplication by I, rotate this L into subspace, which is orthogonal to itself. So you can also talk about non-linear some surfaces which also Lagrangian, which means that if you take every tangent plane and multiply by I, it becoming orthogonal to itself. And turns out that if it's graphical, then in this coordinates P and Q, then this Lagrangian condition just means that so it's a P equal F of Q, but P and Q are vector here. So it's a P1 is equal F1 of Q, P2 P, F2 of Q, etc. And Lagrangian condition means that all this coordinate function of F are partial derivative of some just one function H. So this is a kind of simultaneous graph of all partial derivative of function. It's very much reminiscent to this picture of contact geometry which I told you. So symplectic geometry came as a geometric language for mechanics. So in you know that mechanics, kind of classical mechanics, described by Newton equation, and Newton equation are equation of second order, right? Differential equation second order just says that acceleration is equal to force. And you can reduce, if you take one equation of second order, you can reduce to two equations of first order. And kind of by doing this trick, you can rewrite this equation as system of equation of first order, and you get equation of kind of this form, which is called Hamiltonian form of mechanics. And so the meaning of this equation of mechanics is that you have some configuration of space of the system and the Q are coordinates in this configuration space. And P is, you can say, velocity or more precisely, momenta of the corresponding coordinates. And H has a mechanical meaning of full energy expressed to coordinate in momenta, and then you have this very simple form of equation of mechanics, Hamiltonian equation. So this solving this equation, you find this P and Q depending on time, and you have this, you get this evolution of the system. And so this evolution of the system defines what is called phase flow of our mechanical system, and this phase flow is called Hamiltonian flow and consists of Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. And Poincaré discovered that this Hamiltonian flow preserves symplectic form. So all of them, so this is kind of like principal role of this of mechanics is of symplectic geometry in precisely in this place that this any phase flow of any mechanical system preserves symplectic form, and this will have a really huge kind of consequences as we'll see. So it's also if it's conservative system, if H the energy is independent of time, that means that you have a energy preservation law, and it's then our flow is tangent to the level set of our Hamiltonian. So again, like in two-dimensional case, it implies that there is an enormous number of the symplectic transformation preserving symplectic form. And unlike Euclidean case, when you have a very rigid situation, in here we have an enormous group of symplectic transformation called symplectomorphism, and in mechanics they call canonical transformation because they preserve canonical form Hamiltonian equation, and they also preserve volume, but it's the symplectic transformation is very special part of the volume preservation transformation in if dimension is greater than two. So, as I said, the Poincaré, this great French mathematician who lived in the late 19th century, beginning of 20th century, and he was very much, in fact, related to Swedish mathematical school, and he was really instrumental to kind of to pushing this idea of studying symplectic geometry, although he didn't know yet this word symplectic, but he already knew what geometry is. And, you know, by the time of Poincaré, at this time, like classical mechanics was mostly oriented to trying to really integrate some particular equation of particular mechanical system. And for instance, Poincaré spent enormous effort understanding so-called three-body problem, so understanding the motion of three bodies governed by Newtonian gravity. And what he actually proved that this problem is non-integrable, so it's not possible to really find solution. So what can we do? At this time, computers were not so great, and so he couldn't really solve this numerically on computer. So then he turned, what kind of question we can answer? Then let's try at least answering some qualitative question about this system. So for instance, are there a periodic orbit, and how many periodic orbits, are this orbit stable, and et cetera. So, and then he had this kind of fantastic idea that just maybe this property of preservation of symplectic form is such a strong property that maybe just exploring this property, you can already prove a lot of results. And this is like what he said about periodic orbits, kind of pretty poetic statement. But let's move on. So, in particular, Poincaré was studying the following question. So he was interested in, as I said, in three-body problem, and in particular, there is some special kind of simplest case of three-body problem, so-called restricted three-body problem, when you have two massive body and one third one, small one, and where we kind of can neglect influence of the small body to other. And in this case, we are all known integral. Everything reduced to system with so-called two degree of freedom, and then phase space of the system four-dimensional, and in addition, you have this energy integral, and therefore, you have our flow, in fact, lies on three-dimensional level set of this energy level of this our system. And, like, imagine you have this our 3-space, and this orbit system in the space, and they describe motion of system. And then, if you have a one periodic orbit, you can like follow this periodic orbit and get what they call Poincaré return map. And the fixed point of this Poincaré return map is exactly other periodic orbit which are nearby this one. And Poincaré kind of interested was precisely in this case and very specific situation. And he encountered the following question, that suppose we have this formulated the following purely two-dimensional geometric problem. Suppose you have an annulus, two-dimensional annulus. And suppose you have an area-preserving transformation of this annulus, which is twist boundary component in opposite direction. And then he said, this transformation must have at least two fixed points. So this is in order to understand what it means, so it's better not to take this annulus, but unwind this annulus to infinite strip and think that there is some kind of periodic transformation of this infinite strip. And then, because if you take an annulus, it's not clear what does it mean it twists in opposite direction, because it twists 180 degrees, I cannot tell you in which direction it twists. But in this case, it's clear that it's kind of shift one in this direction, another in that direction, and therefore, you want to say that it has to have some fixed point. So this is what I draw. This is you have one vertical line, and this is an image on this line under our map. So if it's not area preservation, that's very easy to see that no fixed point are necessary, because you can kind of, whatever you do, you can everything then shift upward by some amount, and therefore, by shifting everything sufficiently upward, you can remove all fixed points of this transformation. So Poincaré had the following argument. So he actually never proved the theorem. He said, he wrote a paper about the theorem, which was a very dramatic paper. He said, well, I'm already very old. He was 66 years old, actually, this time. But I'm already very old, and so I don't know if I will be able to finish this. And so I'll just present this all evidence which I collected for the proof. And he considered like 1,000 special cases, and in each he proved it, but he still couldn't prove the theorem. And indeed, unfortunately, he died a few months after this. And this is a kind of his kind of argument for the proof. He said, okay, so let's first consider the case with this transformation not too far from just identity, just so we move a little bit. So if we move a little bit, then let's just consider graph of this transformation. So this transformation was on annulus, but you think this annulus, that it's a strip, kind of periodic translation of strip, and you extend it to the whole plane by adding translation by some amount c on the top and translation by amount minus c on the bottom. And they take a graph of this transformation. So graph of this transformation will be some surface in four-dimensional space. And then if it's not far from identity, so if it's well identity, the graph of the transformation will be just diagonal. But if it's not too far from identity, then it's still graphical with respect to different splitting of coordinates, QP capital and P capital Q. And then he just argued that this area preservation property, that dp dq equal dp dq, kind of amount that, that this the difference between this form is a d of this pdq plus qdp is equal to zero, and it implies that this form have to be differential of h. I already told you a little bit about this, but if you don't understand that, just kind of sleep for next 2 minutes before I finish. So anyway, and what it implies that fixed point of our transformation is just p equal p capital q capital equal q, they are zero of this differential form, and zero of this differential form, and that means that they are critical point of this function. Critical points of function is function where the function of two variable and where it's extremal point of this function where both first partial derivative vanishes. And so you get the following picture. You get function, which is you can check that with respect to one variable, it's a periodic. And with respect to other variable, it looks like this. So it's kind of equal plus minus c times this p coordinate. So it looks like this. And this implies that this function must have somewhere maximum, somewhere saddle points. And these 2 points are critical points of our function. So therefore, the fixed point of this transformation. So this Poincaré argument, in fact, this, that it's not too small, that means that image of every straight line looks like something like this. But unfortunately, it can look something like this. So it's not really Poincaré argument, not quite work, and Poincaré really tried to consider many, many cases what geometry of this curve could be and what how it can evolve. But it didn't quite work. So then came Birkhoff, this American mathematician, and like 3 months after Poincaré died, he found some proof of the theorem. But the proof he found was extremely clever, but unfortunately, it was too clever. It was so clever that it was not possible to generalize it to anything else. So it just left as some kind of curiosity and not useful for anything else. And so for next, so kind of what is important, like I forgot to mention, that in this Poincaré really found extremely important feature in this his proof, that when we consider this fixed point as an intersection of this graph with a diagonal, so this intersection, what he didn't say this word, but what he really observed, that this both diagonal and the graph, they are Lagrangian submanifold. And so what and this Lagrangian submanifold, they look like graph of function and its derivative. And therefore, this reduced to the question about finding critical point of function, and this was a crucial kind of insight. And but again, unfortunately, proof which Birkhoff found was completely different. Okay, anyway, so what was important that what Poincaré observed, that if you consider graph, so if you have a Lagrangian manifold, and if it's graphical with respect to the splitting small pq and q capital p capital, then Lagrangian means that it's a graph of area preservation map. But if it's graphical with respect to different splitting, Lagrangian means that these coordinates are partial derivative of some function. So then came, so 50 years more later came Arnold, and Arnold really formulated Poincaré dream. So Poincaré just dreamed, and Arnold said what Poincaré dream actually was. So, and he said, well, what this thing is about, as I explained, about the following things, that this fixed point of symplectic transformation have to be governed by Morse theory. And Morse theory is precisely theory about counting number of critical points of function. In particular, he said, for instance, if you have a, in two-dimensional case, you have a torus, and you have an area preservation map of the torus, then you have to have 4 points on this one if it preserves so-called center of mass. You see, on the torus, you can rotate torus around itself. You don't have any fixed point. You need to have some kind of extra condition for this one. Anyway, so I'm short of time, so maybe I'll skip a little bit this thing. So Arnold conjecture, it is kind of was a, for instance, even for the torus, it was a generalization of Poincaré theorem. You can easily deduce case of Poincaré theorem for Arnold conjecture, but Berghoff proof was completely inapplicable in this case because it was, so this was like first my result in this area. I proved Arnold conjecture for two torus and other two-dimensional surfaces in 79. So at that time, it was not at all clear that this Arnold conjecture in dimension higher than two should be true, because this was a, could be just purely two-dimensional phenomena in high dimension, nothing, there is no rigidity exist. And Gromov at this time formulated this alternative, and he said either, so in fact everything kind of reduced to the following question. So you consider this Hamiltonian symplectic transformation. And suppose you can approximate some other transformation, C0, without derivative, but C0 approximate by some diffeomorphism by symplectic. Is it true that the limit is, again, symplectic, or it's only true it's volume preserving? So if it would be true that it's volume preserving, that would cancel all Arnold conjecture and show that Arnold conjecture, in fact, in high dimension, not true, and that would close the subject. As I said, mathematician created this new world, and all this world of symplectic topology was created. But then, if it would be this alternative resolved in this sense, that would close the subject, and we wouldn't be here. Well, I wouldn't be here today. So, anyway. I have a little bit short of time. Let me skip most of this stuff. So just me say that, okay, so I proved this conjecture, this resolved this Gromov alternative in 81 in favor of frigidity, and there was a other at the same time proofs was a Benneken proved in contact case, and Conley-Zender proof Arnold conjecture for Torrey arbitrary dimension. It's also implied resolution of this alternative. And then Gromov came up with some kind of fantastic paper about pseudo-holomorphic curve in symplectic manifold, and this paper really exploded the subject. So what really Gromov did, he at this time already was another great mathematician Simon Donaldson, who applied some idea from gauge theory to loud dimensional topology, where he used solution of some elliptic PDE of self-dual Young-Mills equation for defining invariance of four manifold. And Gromov realized the same scheme using so-called holomorphic curve in symplectic geometry. And this enormous number of results follows. So symplectic rigidity was really start blossoming. So Gromov proved that there is no exact Lagrangian torus. So exact Lagrangian torus minus Lagrangian submanifold means that if you have a Lagrangian in Euclidean space, and if symplectic area of any disk with boundary in this Lagrangian is equal to zero, then it's called exact. So in two-dimensional case, of course, if you have an embedded curve in the plane, then it has to bound some domain of positive area. And so it, in order to be exact, it has to be self-intersected. But in high dimension, this is, of course, not so clear. But before Gromov's paper, it was an open problem for many years. So he proved, he defined what is called Gromov's symplectic width, some invariant, and implied his famous non-squeezing theorem. That if you have a poly disk, if you take the product of small disk times big disk, and if you can symplectically embed it to another disk times even R to N, then the second radius must be bigger than this one. So this is Gromov's non-squeezing theorem. And he proved a lot of other results. So he planned to do more, but never wrote the second part. And then when, even without his work, this subject started to develop with very fast. A lot of great mathematicians enter, and a lot of great results was proven, and still continues to be proven. And meanwhile, flexible side also kept developing. So was a mathematician, Larry Goose, which in 2008, he proved some kind of constraint on how far this Gromov non-squeezing can develop. So he showed that, you know, Gromov non-squeezing implies that if you have one poly disk and you can symplectically embed to another, then first radius less than second, and the also volume constraint should hold. The product of first radius should be less than product of second radius. But Larry Goose said, and many tried to find some constraint on intermediate radius for, and what Larry proved that up to some constant, there is no other constraint. This was a flexibility result on this one. So you see, while holomorphic curve kind of was developing this rigid side, so this rigid side kept kind of expanding, this flexibility result was moving from other side, and like what we all kind of striving to find this precise boundary in the symplectic world between this rigidity where this cold area and this kind of extremely hot flexibility domain lies. And let me mention a couple of minutes, I've already over time, that there was a lot of recently found flexibility new result in very last few years, where all of them has the following feature, that as soon as you have some kind of small feature implanted in all this symplectic Lagrangian object, some kind of small virus. And this virus kill all rigidity constraint. And after that, everything becoming possible. So this, for instance, as I already mentioned, this result about over-twisted contact structure, and also Professor Ekholm mentioned it, and recently we kind of similar thing with, we proved with my student Emmy Murphy and Strom Bormann in high dimensions, and then Emmy Murphy discovered that you can do the same thing with Legendrian submanifold. As soon as you implant certain thing which he called loose chart, it becoming again very flexible. And then we proved with Murphy that you can do the same with Lagrangian manifold. If you implant some kind of singular point, you can, for instance, replace it also by one intersection point or by changing topologies, again become flexible. And then we use it together with Ekholm, Murphy, and Ivan Smith to disprove some popular conjecture about minimal number of self-intersection points of Lagrangian manifold. Because what was corollary of Gromov theorem, that Gromov theorem was that exact Lagrangian submanifold must have self-intersection point, but how many? And there was many conjecture about what this Lau bound have to be, but turns out that in fact this H principle, this the only kind of indeterminacy is one and two, for instance. In three-dimensional case, one intersection point always enough. So there's a growing wave of new and new results on this flexibility side, and there is also successful ongoing race on the other side, producing new constraints and invariants, and this flexibility and rigidity continue to converge. Thank you very much.